Doctor Who and the Leisure Hive by David Fisher. Read by Lalla Ward. Chapter 1. Brighton. The deck chair attendant shivered in the cold wind off the sea and cursed for the thousandth time yet another chilly English June. It was going to rain again any minute, he complained to his friend the candy floss seller. That's all they needed to complete a perfectly miserable day. Anyone with a ha'porth of sense was sure to be in the cinemas or the pubs or the amusement arcades. The beach was deserted. Who'd be fool enough to rent a deck chair in weather like this? He pulled his coat collar up round his ears, leaned on the iron balustrade of the promenade, and surveyed the row of beach huts. Then something caught his eye. That was odd. There was a police box at the end of the row of beach huts. Funny he'd never noticed it before. And he thought he knew Brighton Beach like the back of his hand. What was a police box doing on the sand? Didn't make sense. Coppers would get their feet wet when the tide came in. In front of the police box, he could see a deck chair. Not one of his, unfortunately. Wrong colour. So perhaps they'd brought it with them. And there was a fellow slumped in the chair, with a brightly coloured beach ball and a bucket and spade by his side. He was wearing an overcoat, a large hat pulled over his eyes, and a long scarf wrapped round his neck. The deck chair attendant approved. Very sensible way to dress for a day on the beach. That's what made this country great, he thought nostalgically. A steadfast refusal to be deterred by facts. You come to the seaside for the day and, regardless of whether there's 6 feet of snow along the prom and icebergs are floating down from Hove, regardless of the fact that you're cold, miserable and your boots are beginning to let in water, you come and sit on the beach, even if it kills you. And with this wind, it probably will. Wait a minute. There was someone else out there. A girl. And what looked like... No, it couldn't be. He could have sworn it was a metal fox terrier. A new breed, perhaps. Mind you, he said to his friend the candy floss seller, when you consider miniature dachshunds, I suppose anything's possible. The doctor was sulking, Romana decided. He couldn't possibly be asleep, not in this freezing wind. He'd got the coordinates of the TARDIS all wrong yet again, and just because she'd remarked on this, in a perfectly friendly manner, he'd gone into a huff. She picked up a stone and threw it violently into the slate-coloured sea. There must be somewhere in this whole galaxy, she remarked to K9, where one can enjoy a proper holiday without being frozen to death.
There is, Mistress.
Oh, I'm delighted to hear it. Taking this as an invitation to exercise his memory banks, K9 began to recall the list of recreational facilities available in the galaxy over a period of 2,000 or 3,000 years. Romana picked up the beach ball and disconsolately began to bounce it.
Yegros Alpha,
droned K9, approaching the end of the list.
Speciality, atavistic therapy of primitive asteroid. Zarkros, galaxy's largest flora collection, including 819 carnivorous species. Zine 4, historical reenactments.
Reenactments?
You choose what episode in history you want to see reenacted or take part in yourself. One proviso, however.
What?
Reenactment of 20th century Earth history forbidden, considered to be too violent.
Quite right, said Romana, angrily smacking the beach ball so that it bounced head high. That's always the problem with Earth. They never do anything constructive.
Sea bathing, mistress.
Hmm?
Traditional Earth exercise when at the seaside.
Well, you try it then, said Romana. She threw the beach ball into the sea. Fetch! The brightly coloured ball bobbed about in the surf about 10 yards out. Obedient as ever, K9 trundled down the damp sand and into the water. There was a loud hiss, a flash, a cloud of blue smoke, and K9 began to sink as seawater seeped through the joins in his metal skin. Oh no, K9! Called Romana. I'm coming! She took off her shoes and plunged into the surf. The doctor woke up to discover an indignant Romana with wet feet and a sorry-looking canine in her arms, standing over him.
"Look what you've done!" she stormed. "You've not only got our holiday dates wrong, you've forgotten to update the programme for canine seawater defences. He's waterlogged."
She shook the dog-shaped computer. The doctor could hear water sloshing around inside the metal animal. But he had problems of his own. "It's the second time I've missed the opening of the Brighton Pavilion," he complained.
"What are you going to do about K9?
Demanded Romana.
"Oh, I'll fix him some time," the doctor yawned.
"It's the sea air," he explained apologetically.
"Oh, well, I'll try setting the coordinates again."
He rose to his feet and began to fold up his deck chair.
"I've got a better idea," said Romana. "Before he got soaked, K9 gave me a complete list of recreational facilities in this galaxy."
The doctor was struggling with the deck chair and didn't reply. He'd always liked Earth. It was his favourite planet. But he had to admit that some of their artefacts, like deck chairs and motor mowers and telephones, seemed to be designed with malice aforethought, rather than with the intention of making life easier for everyone. There was, he reflected, a streak of technological sadism amongst Earthlings.
"I like the sound of Argolis."
"Argolis?" the doctor muttered indistinctly. He was sucking his finger, having squashed it in the wooden frame of the deck chair.
"First of the leisure planets, with a recreational centre called the Leisure Hive, and an experiential grid."
"What's that when it's at home?" inquired the doctor.
"It offers variable environments designed to stimulate physical, psychic and intellectual regeneration," explained Romana, parroting K9.
"Sounds like Morecambe on a bad day.
Ow! Oh, give me that!"
Romana put down K9 and disentangled the doctor from the deck chair, which she then neatly folded up.
"Come on," she said. "Argolis, next stop."
She entered the TARDIS, followed by the doctor, grumbling, with K9 tucked under his arm. The deck chair attendant rubbed his eyes.
"I don't believe it," he said to his friend, the candy floss seller. "That police box, it's just vanished."
"Flaming hooligans," replied the other gloomily. "That's who I blame. And comprehensive education. And free school milk. I knew it'd end badly."
"You don't understand," protested the deck chair attendant. "It vanished, disappeared into thin air."
But the candy floss seller wasn't listening. He'd just spotted a lone Japanese tourist burdened with cameras and three small children, and it was a well-known fact in Brighton that the Japanese found candy floss irresistible.
Chapter 2. Argolis. Nothing prepared you for the miracle of Argolis. Everyone's first reaction on arriving on the planet was the same, sheer gawping wonder. Even the most experienced space travellers were reduced to open-mouthed bumpkins, unable to believe their eyes. One of the great hyperspace lines brought you into the orbit of the planet. There you changed to a shuttle, in which you descended to the surface. On landing, you pressed the button on the android stewardess, which automatically signed you off the shuttle's passenger log. Then you stepped out of the craft onto a moving hover pavement. This carried you gently, silently, up a long tunnel, the walls of which were a uniform dove grey. The tunnel was suffused with a subdued light. The effect was faintly claustrophobic, but not for long. It wasn't enough to cause any distress. At last, the pavement deposited you in the first great observation hall of the Leisure Hive. The contrast with the tunnel was breathtaking. It was like emerging from a womb and stepping onto an immense stage. All around you was glass. You stood inside a huge inverted bowl. Outside, you could see the pitted surface of the planet stretching away to the horizon, while overhead arched an immensity of sky. The effect was as if you had been suddenly immersed in a sea of light and colour. Brilliant light, incredible colour. No rainbows anywhere in the galaxy ever boasted such colors.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.